Okay, in order to understand compounding, it's important to have a working understanding of steam. So here it comes, a very, very basic explanation of how steam works in a locomotive context. Fortunately, we live on a planet with an abundance of water, and therefore we're familiar with water in all its forms, be it ice, the liquid, or the vapour. Now, because of our familiarity with boiling water, we tend to think of it as being 100 degrees Celsius for a boiling point, whatever that is in the old money, and we think of it boiling at atmospheric pressure. But in the steam locomotive context, it's more important to think of it as being not just steam, but a combination of temperature and pressure. So here it goes, let's get into it. Now, back in the days of the Liverpool and Manchester Railway, the typical locomotive weighed about 7.5 tonnes. It had, say, a 5-foot-high driving wheel. It had 12 by 16-inch cylinders and carried 50 pounds per square inch on the boiler. Why is that important? It's important because at 50 pounds per square inch, the boiling temperature of water is not 100 degrees Celsius, it's something like 138 degrees Celsius. That water changes to steam through the application of heat. That heat comes from the firebox, and in adopting the heat from the firebox, the water changes its nature into a vapour. That vapour has the characteristic of 50 pounds per square inch of pressure and 138 degrees of temperature. When that steam is admitted to the cylinder and then cut off, it's left to expand to do the useful work of turning the wheels and thus making money for the directors of the Liverpool and Manchester Railway. When the counterstroke exhausts that first packet of live steam, it's exited up the chimney. It has a much lower temperature and a much lower pressure. It still does some useful work for the locomotive in that it creates the draft that helps draw the firebox heat and gases through the boiler tube, thus creating more steam to perpetuate the continuation of the locomotive. Now, 50 pounds per square inch in 1834 is one thing, but if we fast forward to when compounding more or less took off, we're talking more along the lines of 200 pounds per square inch on the boiler. And the 200 pounds per square inch of steam on the boiler boils at a temperature that's nearly twice as high as what it takes us to make a cup of tea. So the parcel of steam admitted to the cylinders is significantly more powerful and significantly more potent than back in 1834. And when it expands and does its work and trades off some of its heat and some of its pressure into that work and is then exhausted out the chimney, it still contains a very useful amount of heat and a very useful amount of pressure. And compounding seeks to adopt that exhaust steam and use it a second time before exhausting it. As an aside, in the marine engineering context, they had solved the issue of triple expansion by the 1880s, and in doing so, they completely revolutionized shipping. The triple expansion engine was significantly lighter than a simple version because the intermediate cylinder and the low pressure cylinder could be more lightly constructed because they were carrying lighter pressures. They could also be mounted vertically, so they occupied a lesser footprint of deck space. And because we're dealing with a multi-decked ship, they could occupy on that same footprint a couple of decks. They use less water, which is important in the marine context because the feed water is condensed after use. They use less fuel, which is also important because the whole point is to assign as much of your hold space as possible to paying cargo rather than coal. Rail is significantly different to sea, even though they are both steam powered. For instance, there's up and down hill work, which we don't get on the ocean. There's the need to comply with timetables, there's the need to make up for time, there's the constant stopping and starting. All of these things do not feature at sea. There's also the requirement for a higher rotational speed, a much higher rotational speed than a steamship needs. But compounding offered so much promise that exceedingly detailed attempts were made to harness exhaust steam into useful work. And the best way to examine that harnessing of that exhaust steam in a locomotive context is to look at the most straightforward arrangement, which is cross compounding. So here we go. Cross compound locomotive has a high pressure cylinder on one side. As normal, it's located adjacent the smoke box. On the opposite side, unlike a simple locomotive where the cylinder would be identical, there is a larger low pressure cylinder. It's easy to spot a cross compound locomotive because that cylinder, the low pressure cylinder, is oversized for the locomotive. And in some contexts, the cylinder got so large that they had to shave off the casing of the cylinder and give it a smooth face, and they have the appearance of being octagonal in cross section. So that's a sign of a cross compound locomotive. Now, if you imagine the parcel of steam that comes from the boiler to the high pressure cylinder, it occupies a certain space when it's cut off. It does its expansion. In doing so, it occupies a greater space. In doing the work, it trades off temperature and pressure. Instead of being exhausted out the chimney, it's transferred to the other side of the locomotive, where it is admitted to the low pressure cylinder. Now, because of the growth in volume between the parcel admitted to the high pressure cylinder and the parcel exhausted from the high pressure cylinder, the low pressure cylinder needs to be bigger. And it's normally 2 to 2.5 times the size of the high pressure cylinder. And that's to allow a useful amount of that low pressure steam into the cylinder to do hopefully equal work with the high pressure cylinder. From there, it's exhausted up the chimney. So it's used twice. We have a double expansion. In terms of complexity, a cross-compound locomotive is nearly as straightforward as a two-cylinder simple locomotive. In fact, you could argue that it's more straightforward because it only has one valve controlling the two cylinders. And that would be true, except that locomotives have a 90 degree offset of the crank pins. And they do that because there's a roughly 1 in 12 chance that a locomotive, when it comes to a stop, will have one of its cylinders at dead center. Now, if a cylinder is at dead center, it means that the admission port for its cylinder is shut. That's not a problem on a simple locomotive because the 90 degrees offset means that the other cylinder is wide open. And normally there's enough slack in the train for one live cylinder to push the locomotive through a half turn of the driving wheels to get the other cylinder into power. But on a cross compound locomotive, the problem is this. If it's the high pressure cylinder that is brought to a stop at dead center, it means the boiler steam comes to a stop when it hits that valve, and there's no way for it to get to the low pressure cylinder to help push the locomotive through that half turn. So an intercepting valve is part of the mix. And what that valve allows for is boiler steam to go directly to the low pressure cylinder. It adds complexity. The valve is more complex than a normal valve you would get on a simple locomotive, but it has the advantage of offering more than the theoretical maximum and tractive effort when a locomotive starts. So compound locomotives tend to be very competent at starting a train compared to similarly powered simple locomotives. After a couple of turns of the driving wheels, the interceptor valve shuts off, either automatically or by operation of the driver, and normal flow of steam from high pressure across the low pressure and then out the chimney resumes. So the advantages, they're straightforward mechanically, even with the interceptor valve. They are very easy on the water, which is something that's often overlooked when considering compounds. The Atchison, Topeka and Santa Fe Railway, for instance, had very bad water, so it liked to save water because that lessened the burden of boiler maintenance. They're also lighter on the fuel. Again, for the AT and SF, who had to import their fuel because they didn't serve much in the way of coal mines, that was an added saving that, that went beyond a mere analysis of the pounds of coal consumed per tonne hauled. Disadvantages were asymmetric thrust, for instance. There's a very narrow band of throttle setting and cutoff setting where the high pressure and low pressure cylinder produce the same piston thrust. And outside of that band, you tended to get oscillation when one cylinder was producing more power than the other. That band tended to be in a low speed range, which wasn't a problem for freight locomotives back then, because freight locomotive speeds were ridiculously slow. There's another problem, and that is when the locomotive is up and running and the driver wants to adjust the cutoff to let a smaller packet of steam in, what tended to happen was that smaller packet of steam occupied a proportionately greater area after it had done its power stroke and therefore lost more temperature and more pressure than a bigger packet of steam, which meant that when it was transferred to the low pressure side, it didn't have a full measure of power to give. What tended to happen was that the locomotives would surge at anything above a normal road speed, with that high pressure cylinder leading the way and the low pressure cylinder trailing behind. Ordinarily, road speed is road speed, but if a train is called upon to make up time, and if the railroad is running by book, then the act of pushing the locomotive beyond its comfortable speed range resulted in that surging, which resulted in greater wear of the components. But at low speed, normal speed, expected speed, it wasn't necessarily a problem. There's another advantage of the cross compounds that the other compounding setups did not enjoy, and that is on the way over from the high pressure cylinder to the low pressure cylinder, the intermediate steam passed through the smoke box and thus absorbed some heat and increased its temperature, and hotter steam is happier steam. So with the increase of temperature came an increase of pressure. When it came to finally exhausting the steam after the two expansions, that exhaust steam was at a lower pressure compared to a similarly powered simple locomotive. It therefore meant that less heat and less firebox gases were being drawn through the boiler, which therefore dampened down the boiler's ability to make steam. The way to alleviate, and this is common across all compounds, was to make the exhaust nozzle smaller to create a greater draft. That had the problem of increasing back pressure on the low pressure cylinder, thus meaning that the full theoretical potential of that low pressure cylinder was robbed. And this goes back to the ratio of roughly 2 to 2.5 times the size of the high pressure cylinder. A lot of that range and ratio has to do with the boiler pressure, which contributes ultimately to the pressure of the exhaust steam. The higher the exhaust steam pressure, the larger the exhaust nozzle, the lesser the back pressure. It's one of those things that's common in locomotive engineering. Every advantage comes with a disadvantage. It's all about trade-off. But saving water, saving coal, was considered significant enough at that time to make up for the disadvantages. And if rail had remained a low-speed enterprise, then cross-compounding probably would have been the last word in compounds. It didn't, and in future episodes, when I get around to making them, we'll have a look at some of those systems. The tandem compounds, the Volklane compounds, the Volklane balanced compounds, and my favourite, the de Glenn balanced compounds. There's also, of course, the Mallet, the ultimate expression in size and power of compound locomotives. I'll get around to that as soon as I get around to it. In the meantime, like, subscribe, enjoy, check on back. Who knows, gonna some stage post something. See ya.